Also in Englisch ist der Bescheid Anscher, Fantasy. Fantasy or Phantasma is not simply we cannot get what we want and then we imagine it. It's not that. Fantasy, the problem is, but how do I know what I want? Because we humans do not have like an animal instincts which tell us what do we want. Through fantasy, we learn to desire. So, when we criticize, some people do, psychoanalysis because of pansexualism, this criticism totally misses the point. The point of psychoanalysis is not whatever you are doing, you really mean that. So that, I don't know, for example, in mathematics, when I solve a problem like how much energy is released when two bodies hit each other, of course, I think about that. The problem of psychoanalysis is, but what do I think when I am doing that? The idea is that when I'm alone with my lover doing sex, it's not enough. I have to have a fantasy. A couple of years ago, they discovered Ludwig Wittgenstein's Tagebücher, diaries from First World War. And he there reports on, very honestly, what he was thinking about when he was masturbating at the front. It was, he wrote, debating with friends mathematical problems. In Hollywood, they went even further. Maybe you saw one of the worst films of all times, Warren Beatty Reds, about that John Reed who participated in October Revolution. It's a film, Reds. There, October Revolution itself is the fantasy which enables the creation of the couple, Warren Beatty, Diane Keaton. For example, when you fall in love with a woman or a man, fantasy is what makes you fall in love with that person. And there is another aspect which is crucial about fantasy. Fantasy is not so much the realization of your own desire, but of others' desire. Because according to psychoanalysis, the original enigma of a human being already as a child is, what do others want from me? A small child experiences himself or herself as a, in the middle of desires, caught in others' desires. My father wants something from me, my father wants something, my mother wants something, brothers and so on. They all expect something from me, it's not clear to me what. And fantasy, we construct a fantasy to get an answer. And I think this goes also, if I simplify, at the social level. At the social level. Is the anti-Semitic fantasy not precisely an answer of a perplexed subject like what's going on in society? What does society want from me? Yes, what I mean is that the anti-Semitic figure of the Jew is the same fantasy. Imagine an ordinary German in 1920s. An ordinary person was totally confused. He saw moral degradation, economic crisis, and so on. He didn't know what is going on. And Hitler provided the answer. The Jew is behind all of this. Another crucial element of fantasy is that fantasy is not opposed to reality. Fantasma is what structures our reality. This is why I still think one should read The Capital of Marx. When Marx speaks about commodity fetishism, he does not talk about some illusions in our head. He talks about illusions that we practice in our social relations. To make maybe these things think more clear, I will give you a short report on a very interesting recent debate in American philosophy. It was a debate about what we know and what we don't know. Now comes the joke. The philosopher in question is, of course, Donald Rumsfeld. In March 2003, He shocked everybody by the following meditation at a press conference. So this is what Rumsfeld says. There are known knowns. There are things we know that we know. Like, I don't know, I know that I am in Praha, and I know that I know. Then Rumsfeld went on, but there are also, there are known unknowns. There are things that we know we don't know. It's common, it's clear what he wanted to say. Like, I don't know. How many cars are now outside this building? I don't know, but I know that I don't know it. Or a more unpleasant example, which concerns us more. Do I have a cancer or not? No? You know that you don't know it, if you don't know it and so on. Okay. Then Rumsfeld went a little bit further and said, but there are also unknown unknowns. There are things we don't know that we don't know. The idea was they are so totally unknown, they're simply outside our horizon of knowledge. This, it's clear what his point was, that maybe Saddam Hussein has something so secret that we even don't know that we don't know it. But did you, and then he stopped here. And again, this is why Americans are losing Iraq. Why? I'm quite serious. Did you notice three elements, but if you make a matrix of permutation of, it should be four. We have known knowns, things we know that we know. We have known unknowns, things that we know that we don't know. And we have unknown unknowns, things which are totally unknown. What is missing? The unknown knowns, things we know, but we don't know that we know them. And this is fantasy. What is true in the United States? When they invaded Iraq, their behavior was regulated, dominated by their ideological fantasies. They will receive us there, celebrating us, and so on and so on. It's precisely the unknown knowns, things that you know, but you do not even know that you know them. Now let's make a step further. Where do we encounter this unknown knowns, things that we know without knowing at its purest? In a very mysterious thing we call habits. Now, what are habits? This, I think, is the most interesting phenomenon. Why? First, let me emphasize the moment of, how should I call it? I will come later to that. 2 points, if you allow me. First, habits, yes. Did you notice how whenever you are caught in a social event, member of some group, whatever. Of course, we all know interaction in a group from family to state is always regulated by rules. But if you look at it closely, things are always, and I claim for structurally necessary reasons, more complex. We never have simply rules, but we also have meta rules, rules which tell us how are we to take explicit rules. And I know communism was terrible, but for me what was so fascinating about communist regime was how it manipulated this gap. On the one hand, we have rules which prohibit something, but between the lines the message is don't take it seriously. In socialism there were many rules like this, or at least this was my experience in serving the army, doing the military service. Many things were there prohibited, but you were a total idiot if you followed the prohibition, no? Like, it was daily life in the army, you had to steal, you had to do it all. And I claim even the majority of sexual prohibitions are like this. Don't mess with girls means if you are a man, do it. And so on and so on. Sexuality is all about this, how to solicit something through prohibiting it. But what we find at its purest in communist regimes, but we find it in different forms also elsewhere, is the opposite. It's